overtime. And Coach Irk Russell had been worried about all this when we talked earlier in the week at the booster luncheon.
I worry about Hugo, the rain that may precede the hurricane. We talked this morning and yesterday in terms of what can our hurricane offense be, because we definitely don't have the kind of offense that we would like to play in a downpour. Where on the other side, Middle Tennessee kind of has a natural hurricane offense. They run the power eye at midfield, they run the eye formation most of the time, and run power stuff straight at you, and can handle the ball without making many mistakes. They're a handoff football team. We're a pitching around the backfield team, and I hope to goodness that Hugo goes somewhere else.
After taking us up to Central Time last year and delaying the game for an hour with a horrendous thunderstorm, don't you think we owe him a hurricane?
No, we really owe him 100 degrees and a lot of naps. We did play under some adverse conditions last year, but gosh, they just beat the slop out of us. 26-10 doesn't really tell how one-sided that game was.
But by the same token, we've traditionally done pretty well with the revenge factor on our minds, too.
I hope we have that on our minds, because that is a great incentive for people who really care. And I feel like we've got some people who really care, and although we hate to lose last year so badly to Middle Tennessee, hopefully we can use that to create some positives for this year.
How's your routine been for the short week?
It's been kind of hurried and rushed up. We've tried not to cram and pack things in a short period of time. We made Sunday was Monday's practice. Monday was Tuesday's practice, and so on down the line. This week we're without a Thursday and a Friday. Excuse me, a Sunday and a Friday.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, I want you to go after and go after them aggressively.
Go after them aggressively. One more time.
Even Super Scout Dr. Pat Spurgeon thought we owed them something after the weather they usually have for us up in Murfreesboro.
Yes, of course. This is such a splendid ball game, I think, between two very solid teams, but I hope that conditions are such that it can be played as it should be played. But if it isn't, yes, I think we owe them one. After 84 up there and after 88 up there, I think we owe them one if it comes down to that. Well, let me put it this way. I don't know whether Hugo will be in attendance, as someone said, but there'll be a hurricane there. It'll be hurricane boots. But there'll be a hurricane here Thursday night.
Fortunately for Georgia Southern, Hurricane Boots turned out to be a bigger dud than Jim Baker's PTL comeback. And we'll have the delightful highlights of the first half after this. Somehow, this weather provided the perfect setting. It's usually on the semi-miserable side when we play MTSU. The game didn't look as though it was going to be so one-sided when Orlando Crenshaw took the opening kickoff 26 yards to the 40 before Mark Giles and Randall Boone could run him out of bounds. But even as premature as it seemed at the time, the first play from scrimmage turned the tide for the Eagles when linebacker Bart Hughes stripped Joe Campbell of the football and Rodney Oglesby fell on it. By the way, welcome back, Bart.
Thanks a lot. It's great to be back.
Tell me about, it looked like everybody was clicking tonight. You were playing in a hurricane, adverse conditions all over, but boy, ball control was the name of the game.
Yeah, we had a great game plan tonight, and most of all, I think everybody went out and played as hard as I've ever seen a team play.
How did you feel going into this ball game? There was a lot to prove for the Eagles tonight.
Well, personally, I was excited because really this is the first week that I've been back and gotten to play a lot. Nervous, just and ready to play.
Bart wasn't alone. All of his teammates were ready to play. On third and three from the MT-29, Raymond Gross was tripped up just 7 yards shy of pay dirt, but it was rough sledding from there for the Eagles against the stubborn Blue Raider defense. On third down, he was stopped a yard shy of the goal line, and Mike Dowis was called on to begin what would turn out to be a record-tying night with the first of four field goals for the evening to put Georgia Southern up for good 3-0. Ironically, it was all the points the Eagles were going to need. and the Eagles appeared to be on the verge of another big break when Darrell Hendricks intercepted a deflected Phil Ironside pass, but all for naught when Kevin Whitley was called for interference. The ball went back over to Middle Tennessee. But if Mr. Ironside and company thought that they were going to run the option against the defense that practices against the best option team in the country, Giff Smith showed them otherwise. It is obvious Giff and the gang are king in Paulson Stadium. Nor did their success rate improve after a punt exchange. Giff was awesome, making duck soup out of Campbell, dumping him for a 3-yard loss. One play later, Kevin Whitley made a sensational diving interception of this Phil Ironside pass. No interference call this time. The ball belonged to Georgia Southern. Or as the kids would say in contemporary language, the defense was positively rad.
Yeah, our defense, we really came to play tonight. I think it all started in calisthenics when we went out there and we see the crowd out there, the students out there hollering, screaming. You know, we had a lot of motivation. We had revenge. We had a lot of things on our side. And we went out there and proved what we could do tonight.
What was it like playing in a monsoon?
It's funny, you know, when you're on the sidelines, you know, you're cold, rain's hitting you in the face, kind of hurts. But when you get on the field, you don't even know it's raining. You know, you get between the white lines, it's just you against them. And the field was in great condition. You couldn't ask for it to be better.
You helped out a lot. You got in there and got some footballs that were intended for somebody else.
Yes, well, since Rodney had a great year last year, I think all the teams can pick on me this year, me and Rondo. So we're just trying to come through.
It was especially difficult in the fact that those balls are hard to hold on to under normal conditions, much less in a monsoon.
Yes, and the fourth quarter had the wind, and that helped them out a lot. But like the second and the third quarter, they was going against the wind, so it helped us out a lot too.
What were they doing that gave you the clues tonight as to where you might want to be?
Well, since the weather was so bad, they were trying to throw a lot of short routes, and so we were just playing. I was hitting the short routes hard, and Boone was covering me over the top. I had nothing to worry about.
The Eagle Express wasted no time showing its appreciation. Raymond on a second down keeper went for 15 yards to the enemy 30. And on second and five, Gross rolling out to his right goes to the air. Darrell Belzer was there, wide open just inside the 15. And on first down, watch the super block thrown by number 52, Brad Bernard, the big Jacksonville senior guard, springing Raymond to the one. And on this first down, it was touchdown. Ernest Thompson doing the honors. 10-0 Southern. By now, the defense was so fired up you'd have thought Dr. Henry was canceling classes for every sack. Mike West was the beast of the East on this play. In fact, Southern's West was refusing to let the Blue Raiders go any direction on the compass. Just ask quarterback Phil Ironside, who kept running into Mike in the most unusual places. By now, Middle Tennessee State found the Eagle defense more confusing than the simplified IRS 1040 forms. So quarterback Phil Ironside decided to call timeout and discuss the strategy with Coach Boots Donnelly. And here's the brilliance they displayed as linebacker Darrell Hendricks went running past offensive guard John Tate like he was bolted on the field, and with a little assist from Patrick Parr, tossed Mr. Ironside for a 13-yard loss.
They pretty much put it to us last year. They said they didn't think we could play in the rain and all this and that, and we just went out and showed them that we had a better team than them, and we had one last year. We just had a bad night. We gave him two hurricanes. We have one coming off the coast, and then we have one in the Blue Thunder.
On the ensuing play, it was time for the Blue Raider turnover of the drive. Here it came. Mike West was on it for Blue Thunder, and the first quarter passed into history. The second quarter began and ended the same way. Mike Dowis kicking 6 more points on the board for Georgia Southern, starting off with a 26-yarder for a 13-0 advantage. And late in the half, Raymond Gross improvised a 22-yard run to the Blue Raider 21, setting up the final score of the first half. In the dying seconds, Mike Dowis put up an important 3 points to give the Eagles a 16-0 advantage at intermission with a 31-yarder that just made it inside the right post. And do you remember the Nevada-Reno infamous Zonies? I think you could probably call these guys the Twilight Zonies. And we'll be back to chat with Nate Hirsch, the voice of the Eagles, after this timeout. Any hopes at all that Middle Tennessee would get back in this one were dashed almost immediately when the Eagles failed to convert on 3rd and 11 and Terry Harbin was called in to punt it away. Blue Raider Orlando Crenshaw was anxiously awaiting at the other end. I got it! But alas, he did not. linebacker Shane Maxwell did. Shane, by the way, plays for Georgia Southern. Conditions being what they were, we saw a lot of Terry Harbin Thursday night. So, Terry, what was it like playing in a hurricane?
Well, I always wanted to play against the Hurricanes, but I wanted Miami, not Hugo, you know what I mean? It was something. It was not only we had to face the number one punt blocking and kick blocking team in the nation, but we also had to go against Hugo, and he wasn't invited. So it was quite an experience, and well, to say the least, it didn't help the old punting average in it either. You know what I mean?
But a credit to your line and your snapper.
Oh man, those guys! I tell you, they buckled down. I mean, they knew. As I said, not only did they have the challenge ahead of them with Middle Tennessee, but they had Hugo and Bubba Crenshaw. He concentrated a little harder than he ever did. You know, that first one he got out of the system. But after that, they were perfect every time. On field goal snaps, extra points, they were there. The guys came through and blocked. And they've done it all year. And I think they'll continue to do it.
On first down, however, we came darn close to giving it right back. A pass was almost intercepted at the goal line by Jimmy McCamey, who had three interceptions already this season. But on third and eight, this was more like it. Raymond rolls right and hits Terrence Sorrell, the pride of Salem, New Jersey, for first down yardage. Meanwhile, Joe Ross was having another career night, bulldozing his way off left tackle for 11 more of his 182 yards. And against Middle Tennessee, extra satisfying.
Oh, yeah, well, we knew from the start that the fullback was going to have to pull the load. And it's to win, the fullback had to have 100-plus, and I think tonight we accomplished that, and that's why I was at 26-0.
And watch the guys in action who never get enough credit. That incredible offensive line. Sammy Twiggs, Sean Gainey, John Wilson, Brad Bernard, and George Jones.
Well, it's kind of easy to put a win up on your board when it's goose egg up on my opponent team's board. The defense did a good job. The offense did a great job. And as a team, we probably played our best game tonight. Well, they had a good defense. They were stuffing people sometimes. But I think the offensive line, Sean Gainey and Twiggs, and Bernard and John Wilson, we did a pretty good job. And I was impressed with the goal line situation that we had. And we just had good ball control, and Raymond held on to it. And we did a good job this week.
Yeah, we were running the ball on them. We were basically running anything we wanted to. Our line really pushed them off the ball, and we got the movement and gave it to Joe, and Joe had a field there.
Just for the second week in a row, he had just a great night.
Yeah, the linemen just did a great job, and, the coaches made excellent calls, play selection, and, we got him the ball, and we knew that we could run inside on him.
Under the most adverse conditions we've ever had here.
Yeah, I think so. I think last week got us a little bit ready for this game, weather-wise, and, working in the warm-ups, we didn't have any problem handling the ball, and I don't think we did really have any problem handling the ball until the end of the game when it really started coming down.
Fortunately, by then, we didn't have to worry about Hugo. The Eagles' final TD came on a second and goal with Ernest Thompson doing the honors for a 23-0 advantage, and all that's left to be chronicled in the scoring department came late in the third stanza when Mike Dowis came on for a record-tying fourth field goal of the night.
Do you have any idea that in a monsoon that you were going to tie Tim Foley's record for field goals tonight?
No, I really wasn't planning on kicking any when I got here. We just went out there and picked a spot, relaxed, kicked the ball, and got real fortunate. Must have had the Lord on my side. I thought he'd be against me, but I must have had him on my side tonight.
This is the first time our field has really been put to the test. We'd always talk about how good the drainage was, but tonight, especially from your standpoint, where you're captain kick off the ground now, this really was a plus.
Oh, yeah. It's a great field. It's amazing how much it drains. I hear it drains faster than any field in the nation, but it was good footing. No problem at all.
All right. Was there any difficulty or was there anything different about kicking in the rain like this?
The wind was the biggest thing, having to put it. Usually when you kick in as short as these field goals were, you really don't have to play the wind, but with the wind we had tonight, especially up high, you really had to play the wind. Even when you were going with it, you had to play it. They got good holds, good snaps from Bubba. The offensive line did a great job, and we just put them through.
And Mike played it like a virtuoso. Meanwhile, the defense wasn't letting a new quarterback bring new life to the Blue Raiders. Darrell Hendricks let that be known in a hurry. And when it was punting time again, Randell Boone got a hand on it. And most of the night, Rodney Oglesby played it cool back in single safety.
Well, it was coming down pretty hard, and the coaches told me just to sit back there, and if I couldn't see it, get away from it and let everybody else know if it was a short punt or a long punt. But visibility was pretty bad, so I just got away from most of them.
Well, turnabout's fair play. Later in the game, Eric Eberle of the Blue Raiders batted down a Raymond Gross pitch and recovered it as well. But then watch tall, lean, and mean Troy Donahue out of Savannah bat down this pass. And just when it looked like the Blue Raiders were driving, it was Randall Boone to the rescue with a big interception.
You know, we get better because we face the best. And our corners did a real good job supporting the run on the, you know, and that's where they hurt us last year on the perimeter. And our corners and our linebackers and the D-line did real well, you know, keeping the offensive linemen off the linebackers. So, you know, we had a pretty good game all around.
From there was a piece of cake. A soggy piece of cake. And Urkel have final comments in a moment.
Hello, I'm Dr. Pat Spurgeon, coach of the Georgia Southern Eagles. For a coach who only drives back and forth to work, any old car or truck will do. But for a coach who drives thousands of miles from the dark bayou country of Louisiana to the snow-covered plains of Illinois and Iowa, there's only one car, Ford. And for me, there's only one Ford dealer. Metaphor, the family Ford dealer.
The Middle Tennessee game, Team Irk last year that totally embarrassed us. They gave us a thunderstorm. Tonight we gave them a hurricane and returned the favor.
Well, it was, you know, the conditions were a lot alike, but tonight the shoe was on the other foot. Our guys were as ready to play, even from the time they went out there for Cal, as I've ever seen them. Bill, if I had had my choice about things today at noon, I would have said, let's postpone this thing and play it Saturday. But I didn't have any choice. ESPN was here, and I sure am glad that they went ahead and played the game, and we've gotten it over. Now we're four down and one to go.
Enjoy your week. After a short week, enjoy your vacation.
Thank you, I will. So much nicer now that this game is under our belt, and I look forward to seeing you whenever.
Okay, thanks, Irk. We'll look forward to seeing you as well. Appreciate you joining us tonight on the Irk Russell Show, and we'll see you again next week with some midseason highlights.
This has been the Irk Russell Show, featuring highlights of Georgia Southern football 89. Tune in next Sunday night at 11 for another look at high-flying Eagle football action on the Irk Russell Show. This has been a presentation of WJCL Television in cooperation with the Georgia Southern Athletic Department.